So last Sunday, I suggested that people are for caring. We're for doing the caring, and we're also for caring for and being cared for. And I suggested that it almost doesn't matter what we care about, as long as we care about something and then let our resources and our energy and our passion follow that caring. But we also touched on this notion that caring is hard. That when we look out at our world, at all the heartbreaking and self-protective and incomprehensible things that people do, it's easy to close down and get cynical. And so that's where we're picking up today. For all that I am encouraging all of us to care, to pour out our life energy into the things that we care about, I have to admit that when we look outside of these walls, it's really easy to be cynical. We have good reason sometimes for wanting to be guarded. We're living in a time of great paradox. The world outside these windows is beautiful and resilient, but at the same time, it's fragile, and it's fraying under the assaults of our technological innovations, and our oceans have gyres of plastic in them, and our ancient trees on the West Coast are burning, and our hearts are breaking. Our culture has accomplished amazing things. Our science and technology have sequenced the human genome and put people on the moon. Our philosophy, our ethics, and our law have expanded the circle of human rights beyond, far beyond, what previous generations have enjoyed. And yet, you look at the front page of the newspaper, or any magazine, or any news program, and there's ample evidence that we're still tangled in bigotry and in greed and in mistrust. We can connect to like-minded people anywhere on the planet with a keystroke on our computer. We have more freedom to move and change and reinvent ourselves than any other generation in history. And yet, we seem to be more disconnected, more deeply and desperately lonely than at any other time in living memory. And all of this is true. And we need to find a way to care anyhow. Despite the horrific things that we know human beings are capable of, we have no choice but put our faith in human beings. This kind of a paradox leads us to what Brené Brown calls a spiritual crisis. Now, I'm going to offer you Brené's definition from a sociologist's perspective of spirituality, so we can think about that together. She defines spirituality as recognizing and celebrating that we are all inextricably connected to each other by something greater than ourselves. And our connection to that something greater and to one another is grounded in love and compassion. We are inextricably connected to each other. All of us, inextricably connected to everyone else. That means, my friends, that we are inextricably connected to people who live in fear, to people who perpetrate violence, and we are also inextricably connected to people who comfort those who are frightened and to people who bind up the hurts and listen to the stories. And we are connected to those ancient trees that are facing fires in California. And we are connected to the land that feeds the plants that feed us, and the people who work the land, and the people who study the stars, and we're connected to the stars themselves. And to move through the high lonesome, and to learn to live with broken hearts, hearts broken open, not hearts shattered into pieces, but hearts broken open. We're going to need to figure out how to live in this sense of interconnection to people and to the planet and to whatever it is that shapes and sustains the cosmos. And that actually requires us to learn something new. We need to learn how to pay attention in some different ways to some different pieces of reality. How many of you, when you get home from wherever you've been, turn on a program, a CNN, the radio, the computer, the TV, some music to keep you company? I think lots of us do this. Lots of us do this. Not all of us and not all the time. But I think there are times in the day when we want to distract ourselves. When we don't want to go deep, we don't want to worry, we just kind of want to be for a little while. And I wondered what it was we were trying to distract ourselves from. And I don't know about you, but I'm afraid that if I'm in absolute silence for too long, and if I go too deep into introspection and look at my own soul, I might discover that deep down, I am no different from all of those people who rape and destroy and shoot other people. And even worse than acknowledging that they're not different from me, I might discover that in some way I am complicit in creating a world where they can do those things that I feel so appalled by. Alternatively, I worry that I might go inwards and discover that there's nothing there. That it's just an echo bouncing around from my ego, and there is no deeper reality, and there is no love that connects me to everything else. And while acknowledging that we're mortal is hard enough, that there's a time when I won't be here and you won't be here, that's hard enough, at least there's no value judgment in being mortal. We're all mortal. But this notion that we might turn inwards and look at our souls and find there's something that is evil or something that is outside of love, that, I think, is terrifying. And so I get it that sometimes we don't want to go there. We'd rather be distracted. We'd rather not have to go to the place where we worry about our complicity in destroying the planet or in how we helped set up the world that's breaking our hearts. But you know what? Numbing out and living only on the surface of things wraps our hearts in bandages. And we cannot feel. And when we cannot feel, we are not fully alive. We stay heartbroken, and we get stuck in the high lonesome where it feels too risky to connect with anybody else. So to get past the fear, to get past the high lonesome and the heartbreak, we're going to need help. The first thing I think we need are stories. Stories that tell us how those we love who went before us got through it, got through the high lonesome, lived past the heartbreak. We need stories that will reframe our experiences and help us make sense of the paradox of pain and beauty that we see outside the windows and encounter in our own hearts and minds. And we need tools and practices that help us pay attention and actually experience the parts of our lives that we want to avoid. And we need a community like this one, a community of trust that will keep us company on the journey and help us hold ourselves accountable. Now, historically, the stories and the disciplines for living with awareness of the miracle of being here at all and the truth of our common interconnected humanity, those stories have been the provenance of people of faith and the reason for religious communities. Don't tune out here. Don't turn away because you think Unitarian Universalism isn't a religious community. It takes just as much faith, and I would argue it is just as non-rational and spiritually challenging to believe in democracy and in human goodness in our time as it is to believe in reincarnation, or ancestors, or an unembodied deity. It takes faith to assert that people are for caring and caring for. And that means that Unitarian Universalism really is a faith tradition. But rather than necessarily placing faith in God, although some of us do that, we also place our faith in the potential wisdom and goodness of humankind and in the interconnectedness of all that lives. And we do that even when the present evidence which surrounds us fails to support our convictions. That's faith. And as Unitarian Universalists, our values and the stories we tell help us pay attention to those pieces of our tradition, those pieces we have faith in, evidence of the wisdom and goodness of humankind and our interconnection. And that's why it's so exciting when something hits the airwaves like Sharpe's War did a year ago. And we see held up for us and the rest of our culture evidence of Unitarian Universalist human beings living out this commitment to inherent worth and dignity, living out this commitment to our interconnectedness. Like Quakers and Buddhists and neo-pagans and earth-centered practitioners and Jews and Christians, this means that we have access to the full toolkit of spiritual disciplines to help us listen past the distractions and embody goodness and wisdom and connection in the world. Now, I have to be honest, when I was in divinity school, we didn't talk much about spiritual practices. We didn't talk much about needing spiritual guidance or support. I don't know whether it went without saying or we were still in that place in our tradition where we hadn't found ways to translate spiritual and religious language for those who might find them uncomfortable. But increasingly, we are finding Unitarian Universalists who have spiritual practices, who work with spiritual directors, and who find both of these things feed their souls and help them live their values in the world. So we have a garage that can't be used to park cars. Don't tell the ECIA. This is a common plight in El Dorado. Our garage is full of tools. Nathaniel, in a previous incarnation, was a cabinet maker and a furniture maker. And so we have tools that cut, and tools that measure, and tools for sticking things back together, and tools for smoothing things, and tools for roughing. We have tools for just about anything you might want a tool for. And every one of those tools has a container that holds it. It has a place on the wall, it has a box, it has a chest, it has a drawer. The first thing you need if you're going to have a toolkit is a container to put all of those tools in. And for Unitarian Universalists, our container, our context, is Unitarian Universalism. It's a tradition with deep roots, with role models and stories, which can hold us while we learn this new way of seeing, and which can keep us rooted so that we don't give in to the winds of distraction which buffet us from the outside. Unitarian Universalism is a very open and spacious context. It allows for a lot of freedom on the parts of the individuals within it. But our values do form a very firm set of boundaries around the edge of our container. And it's just enough to hold us together and to shelter us when things get rough. Now, the second tool is at least one personal practice for being in the moment, paying attention, and listening deeply to your life. As Unitarian Universalists, we get to choose our own practice. Now, this sometimes leads people to believe that there are no Unitarian Universalist spiritual practices because we're not all doing the same one. Unlike a Buddhist community where everyone sits, or a Christian community where everyone is invited to pray, or a Jewish community where you keep kosher, we tend not to have broad corporate spiritual practices, but instead invite people to find the practice that is tailored to where they are in their spiritual journey in this particular moment. And so you might discover, and Scott Alexander has a wonderful book called Everyday Spiritual Practice, which lists a host of things that Unitarian Universalist clergy and lay people do as spiritual practices. You might decide that right now, walking the dog is your spiritual practice. Or maybe it's doing the dishes, or maybe it's keeping a journal, or sitting zazen, or ecstatic dance. It could be any of a number of things that you have committed to and that somehow fills you up and helps you pay attention to our connectedness and to the goodness of life in the world. The third tool. The third tool is an ally. Because most of us are not strong enough to keep looking inward, to keep strong in our conviction of human goodness and our interconnection, if we don't have somebody who might help us. And so that can be an anamkara, a soul friend, another person on the path, and you just agree to meet and check in. Or it could be a formal spiritual director, someone trained in helping people look inwards and ask questions. And there are actually a lot of Unitarian Universalist spiritual directors out there these days. All of my colleagues in divinity school who didn't talk about spirituality
seem to have gone and gotten degrees in spiritual direction as part of their search to figure out what that might mean. The fourth tool in the toolkit is a group of other seekers who occupy a similar but not identical context, who share similar values and commitments, who are exploring similar practices, and who are willing to listen to our struggles and to share their struggles with us. And it's important that that little circle not be an echo chamber, that there be different theologies in our circle and different ages and different worldviews. How many of you have a family member whom you love deeply, who is at the exact opposite polarity of the political spectrum? And you still love them, right? You still love them. And you stay in relationship with one another. We can do that here too. We say all the time, we need not think alike to love alike. And then we don't admit who we really are, to who we really are, out of fear that it might not be appropriate, that it might not be welcomed. And so as we sit in our small circles, we need to make room for difference, and we need to promise to love each other even when we think differently, even when we live differently, because if we don't do that, it's just that echo bouncing around in the room. The reason for these four tools in our toolkit is to help us grow a fifth one. The fifth tool is the strength to live out our values, to live out our belief that people are inherently worthy, inherently good, and that we are all connected. There is no other. To live out that conviction in a culture and a context that might be telling us that we're absolutely insane to think that we're all connected and that everyone has that seed of goodness at their core. Living out our values in the world, especially when the world is not in a place where it's agreeing with our values, takes great courage. You need every ally you can get. You need every tool that will help you stay connected to the experiences in your life that have led you to these values. Now, the tools get sorted differently by different folks and in different contexts or traditions. Quaker Parker Palmer talks about all of them, but he names them differently than Brené Brown does. She names them from a social science perspective. Both of them name them differently than artist Julia Cameron or Buddhist writer Natalie Goldberg or her fellow Buddhist Thich Nhat Hanh. These notions of needing a context and a community and a practice and a guide hold strong across faith traditions and across non-faith traditions for that matter. They are important supports for living deeply and fully in a world that is simultaneously beautiful and heartbreaking. So we're going to try and make it easy for us. We're actually launching a bunch of programs to help you learn the context and create the community and hone the spiritual practice. One of them is called UU Wellspring. There are sign-up sheets and additional information out in the foyer. Another one is called Soul Matters, and we're going to be starting some Soul Matters groups too.
the Soul Matters groups are sort of a subset of what the Wellsprings groups will be. They're not quite the intense commitment of the first program. Experiencing, having that lived experience of our deep interconnection with one another and with all that is, experiencing, tasting, touching, feeling, moving through that sense of love and wisdom and courage permeating our lives and rippling outwards through us into the world. These experiences don't just sustain us. They are, in fact, remedies to our disconnected, disrespectful, fearful, hostile culture. And what's interesting is that the same tools that might heal our hearts might also heal our culture and our world. And so I want to invite you this morning to take a deep breath and to think about going deeper, even if it's scary sometimes. If we do it together, if we're not alone, we might discover something absolutely different than what we're afraid of, and profoundly life-affirming. May it be so.